So today I'll be presenting about ADHD, which is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. So these will be the contents that I'll be focusing on today. So moving on to the first slide, what is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder? According to DSM-5, ADHD is characterized by a persistent pattern of attention, hyperactivity, and impulsivity that interferes with functioning or development. ADHD is a chronic condition that affects millions of children and often continues into adulthood. ADHD includes a combination of persistent problems and such as difficulty sustaining attention, hyperactivity, and also impulsive behavior. Most importantly, there are three subtypes of ADHD which I have not mentioned in the slides, that is predominant inattentive, predominantly hyperactive and impulsive, and combined. ADHD is a neurodevelopmental complication found in 5% of people and affecting 11% of school-age children. ADHD usually occurs more often in males than in females, and behaviors can be different in boys and girls. For example, boys may be more hyperactive and girls may tend to be quietly inattentive. And this is frequently occurring with other mental health conditions more than 50% of the time. Besides, when unmanaged, it is a source of relationship, employment, legal, and financial problems. So usually symptoms continue in adulthood in more than 3/4 of the cases. How does it affect the brain? So ADHD is a disorder which primarily originates in the and affects the brain in different ways. The brain controls and regulates all psychological activities, including assigning tasks to various areas within itself, executing and following functions, and receiving sensory information, coordination of voluntary and involuntary movements, regulating information and behavioral control. So information processing and sharing across vast neural networks is thus essential part of the normal brain functioning. This is achieved by neurotransmitters which transmit a nervous stimuli across the synapses to the nerves. So ADHD is associated with abnormally low levels of neurotransmitters transmitting between the prefrontal cortex area and the basal ganglia. The prefrontal cortex controls the emotional responses, behavior, and what is called judgment, which decides how a certain action is done and the appropriateness of the different actions, while the basal ganglia regulates the impulsive behavior so as to prevent unwarranted automatic responses to stimuli. ADHD causes dysfunction to the prefrontal cortex and the basal ganglia, which results in a lack of alertness, shortened attention span, shorter memory, difficulty in initiation and sustaining activities, and being unable to avoid unnecessary distracting activities. Also, and this is why ADHD individuals have diminished focus. Again, there's a significant difficulty in organizing the brain for performance of any activity which requires planning of more than one step. Because of the behavior which is strongly guided by the impulsivity and experience difficulty in being still or in one place. So moving on to the next slide, which is the thoughts and feelings based on challenges with ADHD. A person with ADHD feels depleted, helpless, inferior, and ashamed. Because ashamed, and they feel that they are judged because they are individuals with ADHD. Therefore, they feel that they are not accepted by the society, and they feel they feel unstimulated, and they feel like they are trapped within a cage of sickness. And then the causes of ADHD. We should know there is no single cause for ADHD, and ADHD is while the exact cause of is not clear. Research efforts continue, and it is said ADHD is caused by a multifactor condition which consists of a mix of environmental, neurobiological, and genetic factors. So focusing on the neurobiological risk of having ADHD, the structural imaging studies show that brains of children with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder are significantly smaller than unaffected control. Even if you compare the frontal lobe and the temporal lobe of the person without ADHD, it looks much bigger in size than the person with ADHD. And if you compare the occipital lobe for the person with ADHD, he has a much bigger one compared to the person without ADHD. ADHD was the first disorder found to be the result of a deficiency of a specific neurotransmitter, and it has been proposed that ADHD is a polygenic disorder due to the addictive effect of genes affecting dopamine and serotonin, GABA, and other neurotransmitters. So then, moving on to the environmental factors, blood relatives such as parent or a sibling with ADHD or another mental health disorder are more likely to have than another person with ADHD in the same family. Exposure to the environmental toxins such as lead, found mainly in paint and paraffin in all the buildings, maternal drug abuse, drug use, alcohol use, smoking during pregnancy, premature birth, and low birth weight, and brain injury. Focusing on genetics, if a parent with so there would be a 50% chance of a child having ADHD if the parent is with ADHD. And when it comes to twins, identical twins, if one of the twins had ADHD, there's 80% chance that the other will also have ADHD. So moving on to the symptoms of ADHD, so these are pretty much all the symptoms according to the DSM-5, that a child and an adult would have ADHD. So the coexisting conditions, ADHD does not cause other psychological developmental problems. However, a child with ADHD are more likely than others to also have the conditions such as oppositional defiant disorder, conduct disorder, disruptive mood regulation disorder, learning disabilities, substance use disorders, anxiety disorders, mood disorders, autism spectrum disorder, and tic disorder, or in other terms, we call it Tourette disorder. Diagnosing ADHD. Parents should begin by consulting a family pediatrician who may test a child or refer the child to a mental health professional. The key to an accurate diagnosis is gathering as much as information about the child as possible. So when it comes to how is ADHD diagnosed, we should know that there's no one test that determines if a person has ADHD or not. The variety of assessments used to diagnose ADHD, and it's mandatory that for a person to be diagnosed or confirmed that he or she has ADHD, he or she has to undergo a lot of diagnosis assessments, which includes developmental history, clinical observations, correlative information, psychometric testing, self-report questionnaires, overlapping conditions, and the treatments. When it comes to treatments, the types of treatments for ADHD include the therapy and the medications. The examples of therapy includes complementary therapy, alternative therapy, integrative therapy, homeopathy, behavioral therapy, which is one of the most common and the usual and the most important one among all, and speech therapy, counseling, home remedies, and etc. And medications usually are the most common ones prescribed are Ritalin and Ritalin. So when it comes to therapy for both patient and the family is very helpful and can gain control on stressful feelings related to ADHD. A common type of therapy is called behavioral therapy, which it teaches children and parents healthy behaviors, and also it teaches parenting strategies for children, which will be really helpful for the parent and the child to cooperate with each other and how to manage disruptive behaviors. And of course, and at cases, for mild cases of ADHD, behavioral therapy alone without medicine would work fine. And moving on to the medication, the main medication used to treat ADHD are stimulants, characterized as stimulants and non-stimulants. So stimulants are the best known for ADHD medications, where between 70 to 80% of children with ADHD have a few ADHD symptoms when taking these fast-acting medications. So prevention is always better than cure. So to help reduce the child risk of ADHD during pregnancy, there's quite a simple thing that you got to avoid. You should avoid anything that could harm your fetal development. For example, don't drink alcohol, use recreational drugs, or don't smoke cigarettes. Protect your child from exposure to pollutants and toxins, including cigarette smoke and lead paint. And limit screen time would be a good thing too, because although still it's unproven that TV screening, the light from the TV screen causes ADHD, which causes severe hyperactivity. And though it's still unproven, it may be prudent for children to avoid excessive exposure to TV and video games in the first 5 years of life. And then moving on to the frequently asked questions, what's the difference between ADD and ADHD? So by definition, ADD stands for attention deficit disorder, and ADHD stands for attention deficit hyperactive disorder. While ADD is an outdated term for ADHD. And how is ADHD diagnosed? And obesity and ADHD, what's the connection? So the connection between obesity and ADHD is, doctors have long known that there's a correlation between ADHD and obesity both in childhood and adulthood. But a new study tightens the connection in the later research. Researchers linked ADHD in childhood to later obesity in women, but not in men. And how is ADHD treated, which we discussed before? And smoking and ADHD, what's the connection? We also mentioned about that before. Is it safe for women with ADHD to take similar medication when she is pregnant or planning on becoming pregnant? So none of the medications used to treat ADHD, including Adderall or Ritalin, are proven to be safe to use during pregnancy, but they are also not proven to be harmful. According to the Federal Drug Administration, therefore, it's always safe and mandatory to make an appointment with your doctor for your consent before taking any medication. And should I tell my employer that I have ADHD? Well, it's always better to inform your employer that you are having this health condition. And especially if you're having a hard time at work, then according to my opinion, that you should tell your employer to your safe side. So yes. So, thank you.